I'm going to stipulate up front that neither one of us are official spokespersons for either pro or con on the neighborhood integrity.
Exactly.
We're just two mere mortals having a conversation. So let's start with this. And I think I emailed you this when we were talking about what our conversation was going to be about. Mm-hmm. Why is a neighborhood integrity initiative the wrong solution for the very problems that provoked its creation?
Mm. That's a great question. I mean, first let me say that the problems that provoked its creation are completely real. Our planning system doesn't work. I would argue that it can't work, and that the way we do planning in California only works in the suburbs, and it's been this way since the 1920s when we started doing it the way we do it now. But the problem is that we tell communities that their plans mean something and they should expect that if they go through this process where they spend years and hours and hours and hours and hours and hours building consensus, as you and I talked about privately, you know, about these plans, they would. It's reasonable to expect that that would mean something. And then a project comes along and it's totally different from the plan and everybody wonders what the hell is going on. That's a real problem. Mm-hmm. And from my side as a developer doing, you know, not doing those kinds of projects, but doing the sorts of projects that are trying to knit communities together, the process doesn't work for us either, because the process we have today is so expensive and so risk-laden. I mean, anybody can sue you for anything, that unless you're doing big, expensive projects, you can't really...
It doesn't pencil out.
And I have a lot of friends who mm-hmm. were very idealistic and mm-hmm. said, I want to do a project that's small and fits in with the plan, and turns out that even these small projects that fit in with the plan, you still need variances all the time because our plans are so microscopic mm-hmm. that you can't both satisfy this section at the same time, so you have to get a variance, and then it opens them up for lawsuits, and they get shut down, and they lose everything. And so it's...
So if we're not doing planning via spot zoning, we're doing it by court rulings.
Even worse. That's almost more the way we're doing it these days.
Right.
Yeah.
The...
Well, and actually, I realize I didn't answer your question, which is why is this the wrong solution for that?
Mm-hmm.
So if you ask me what's wrong with the current process, I would say it's that communities don't really have any influence, any meaningful influence over what happens in the community. Mm-hmm. That planning happens by courtroom and in backroom deals on all sides, mm-hmm. To everybody's detriment. That it's too expensive and too risky to build the sort of projects that are kind of non-corporate that people really want. And
what do you mean by non-corporate? What kind of, like, affordable housing?
Well,
infill?
I don't want to use words like that because they don't even mean anything to me. Projects which are where you as a resident might know the person who's actually developing it mm-hmm. personally, and where you might personally know the tenants who are moving in, and where they're kind of they're the fabric of community, as opposed to something where a developer from out of state comes in, hires some corporate architect from who knows mm-hmm. where, build a project that could be anywhere, and the tenants are all of these national companies that are everywhere, mm-hmm. and so it sort of erases the community. Those are the only things that are viable, really, in our current process. And when I talk to people in communities, that's what I hear, and that's what I see is they feel like their identity is being erased every day by the sort of projects that are happening. And again, the reason for this is the unpredictability of the process, the expense of the process, the kind of insideriness of the process, mm-hmm. all of these, the fact that you need lawyers to do everything. And what the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative will do, I don't know why people aren't leading with this, but the most important thing it does is it completely pulls communities out of planning, 100%.
How would it do that? Because it seems like the centerpiece of the initiative is a two-year moratorium on spot zoning or variances, parcel by parcel, so the city can begin the process of updating these community plans, which you are saying now are really kind of a sop, or I don't know, bait or switch, or I don't know.
Yeah, the way we do them isn't really legitimate. It's not a local thing. It's actually something that happens all over the United States. I've met planning directors from all over the country, and this, you know, it's actually part of the game. Like if you talk to public officials, they will tell you that they don't want the plans to say what they actually want to see getting built because they want the chance to negotiate with developers over extractions, whether they go to, you know, rebuilding the sewer system.
That makes a lot of sense, because this is what I find, this is where a lot of my anger comes from, and people like me who represent other residential areas, is this, what is the process? The process seems corrupt, broken, or it seems to me, what feels to me right now is they don't want to update community plans. Mm. They don't want to open up Pandora's box, so to speak. Because it seems to me that the only way that the pro-density or the deep-pocketed developers or the politicians can manifest their vision is through exemptions and variances. Mm-hmm. They're afraid that if they actually open it up to the communities to say, what is your vision for your neighborhood, the residents' vision would not conform to the visions of these other interests.
Yeah, it may or may not. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, there's always a danger in overgeneralizing, and there really are great people at the city who really do want to do plans right.
Indeed.
And there are some cities that have almost gotten it right. I mean, Denver recently updated its zoning code citywide in an attempt to do away with all the spot zoning. Mm-hmm. As it happened, even they have failed to do it because you just try to plan your day without making an exception, you know.
Right.
But for the most part, it's become much more predictable.
What could we learn from Denver in that case?
Well, what Denver's done is they've adopted what's called a form-based code, and a simplified form-based code. So it says you can build 6 stories, period. You have to build this far back from your lot line or right up to the lot line, period. They've mostly done away with parking requirements because parking minimums kind of mess up
It's a very controversial issue.
It is a controversial issue. Actually, that's absolutely where most cities are going now, because they realize if you want to control parking, you can't do it by controlling development because it doesn't work. You still have parking impacts. The only way you control parking is by managing parking directly through restrictions and things like that, which works a lot better. Regardless of that, the most important thing they've done is they said, here's the envelope you can build in, and that's it. And I think that would work great here.
That in essence what the community plans are attempting to do here in LA?
Well, it's not the way we do plans here. What we have is a very Byzantine, ornate set of codes, where there are exceptions and exceptions to the exceptions and then exceptions to those, and it's not a simple thing that says you can build 5 stories and that's it. What it says is you can build 3 stories, and then if you build 4 stories, your yards change, and if you build 5 stories, your yards change again, and then you have these additional parking requirements. There are all of these things that become like a really complicated physics problem, and nobody, even the city, has any idea what they mean. And so it opens it up for all kinds of interpretation and all kinds of craziness.
Well, and Jill Stewart made a point when I interviewed her that it spawns a lot of speculation, because in LA you can come along, you can buy a piece of property that's zoned whatever, R3, but bank on the fact that through this system of backroom deals or legal interpretations, that you can get entitlements to upzone that property, not with the idea that you're ever going to build anything. Then you turn around and sell this property with the entitlements. And indeed, we've seen that happen a couple of times in the Miracle Mile.
It's
kind of a financial spec. It's a form of gambling in a way. You buy this piece of land in LA, don't pay any attention to how it's selling now.
I mean, I would say that's an exaggeration, but the dynamic is real.
Yeah.
And it makes it hard for people like me and my partner, because we like to do things that are up and up, and we like to finish what mm-hmm. we start. And if a flipper is coming in competing with us over the same property, they're probably going to be able to outbid us, and that's a problem.
Yeah, that's another way to look at it.
Yeah. But to the question of why this is wrong and how it actually takes power out of the communities, the moratorium to me is actually not that big a deal. I mean, to the construction trades,
as a community activist myself, I welcome it. It's like a pit stop. I can refuel, catch my breath.
Well, there are a couple of reasons why it's not that big a deal. I mean, I'm not saying this from the perspective mm-hmm. of the construction trades, who I'm sure it is a very big deal, if that's how you put food on the table. Mm-hmm. But the way the moratorium would work, it's really for these sorts of game-changing projects, which mm-hmm. are not the normal project that's happening. I mean, most projects are pretty workaday, mm-hmm. and they require a variance or two just because our code is so inconsistent. Mm-hmm. But they're not the kind of big zone change and general plan amendment projects that people think of. So the universe of projects that the moratorium would affect is relatively small, but those sorts of big projects have relatively long timelines, and so frankly a two-year moratorium, it could take them 2 years to get through plan check mm-hmm. at this point. So I don't know that it will really change what
they say. The proponents of the initiative say that we'd be basically talking about 20% of the projects, that 80%.
I mean, my point is even that 20%.
By right stuff. There's a lot of by right stuff.
Right, which is generally the worst stuff out there. But
we'll get into that in a minute. Yeah.
But even that 20% or however, mm-hmm. whatever percentage mm-hmm. it is, it's not going to make a big difference to them, because the ones that are under construction mm-hmm. the ones that are going for their building permits, they're going to rush to get building permits now before the initiative passes. And your building permit is technically vested when you've got a complete application.
We learned that with the mansionization. You can change the rules or get an ICO to stop McMansions, but if the permits have already been pulled and issued, they're good to go.
Right. So my point is, I don't know that that's, I mean, it'll affect some projects, but I don't think it'll mm-hmm. have a huge impact on the pipeline of what's mm-hmm. what's going on. To me, the most important thing in the initiative is in Section 5, where it gets into how you can amend the general plan. Mm-hmm. And what it says is that the city may not amend the general plan ever again for the rest of our lives and our children's lives to allow for anything that is inconsistent with the majority of parcels within a quarter mile of any particular parcel that's under consideration. And so that to me is by far the most important thing in the initiative. What it says is no community can influence anymore what the plans say. The formula is built into this initiative. It says if you've got strip malls and Taco Bells and whatever within a quarter mile, that's the only thing that the general plan can say. If you've got, in certain areas it's going to be fine. If you live in a lovely single family neighborhood with nothing else around, that's all that you're ever going to see, and that's great. But I've talked to many people in neighborhoods that are trying to change, South LA, East LA, in many parts of the East Valley, the North Valley, to whom this would be devastating. Because there's no flexibility.
So you're saying that even if they wanted to update their community plans to get out of the strip malls or chrome plating plants or whatever, that they'd be stuck?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it isn't even written in the initiative that you can't exceed the density or anything that's there. What it says is you can't be inconsistent with it. So.
Oh, I see. So you're saying inconsistent with the character. So if the character is chrome plating or strip malls.
Right. And it's very specific. It, character isn't even the term that it uses. It's height, density, use, mm-hmm. intensity of use, mm-hmm. All of those things. Mm-hmm. And you cannot be inconsistent with that when you update your general plan. Which, again, if you're in a completely baked neighborhood that is never going to change mm-hmm. and you never wanted to change, that's fine. But if you ever want to evolve, then you're really stuck.
One of the issues that comes up is these developers just want to go to the hot spots. And I think you're very qualified because you're obviously someone who's willing, probably working in the non-hot spots or trying to. They want to build on the west side, Miracle Mile, Koreatown, Hollywood, pumping zillions of dollars, lots of resources, whether it's political capital, like you said, lawyers, architects, environmental impact reports, so on and so forth. But there's no energy, it seems to me, directed at the parts of town that are crying for development. And it seems to me that if we could take a time out, get the dialogue going, and it's hard work, that perhaps we could better address not just the grievances of those of us who live in very popular, hotspot, trendy neighborhoods.
Don't rub it in.
Yeah, but also address the real needs and hopes of the people who live in East LA or West LA. Because we've got this whole issue with gentrification, I know. So, you know, it feels to me that they keep how many more. Give you an example in the Miracle Mile. Roughly talking from Fairfax to La Brea. We're still doing our fact checking, but since 2000, we've had around 1,700 luxury rate or market rate units built. Cost us right now, we have to do our homework, somewhere between 70 to 100 rent stabilized units.
Okay.
What we've netted in terms of affordable housing is one SB 1818 project that gave us two.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so 1,700 new luxury market rate.
Yeah.
We're an 850 square foot apartment, rents for $3,150 a month. We've lost, to be determined, 70 to 100 rent stabilized, mm-hmm. which is the only vestige of affordable housing we've ever had in the Miracle Mile. Mm-hmm. And in exchange, we get two.
Mm-hmm.
And that, because one of the things I hear about from the pro-density folks is this trickle-down theory. Mm-hmm. Oh no, if we build, it'll lower prices. I haven't seen that in the Miracle Mile. These 1,700 new units have not made anything more affordable. In fact, the rents, even among the rent-stabilized units, when they're deregulated, when they're vacated,
sure.
have shot up through the roof.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
So it's, what is this? And then I saw that the state commission or someone had done a study on this trickle-down. They said, the way it works is that in 25 years, these 1,700 luxury units will so have deteriorated or be run down that they will then be the affordable housing 25 or 30 years from now. Small comfort to folks who want to live or stay in the Miracle Mile right now. In essence, we're saying, well, come back in 25 years. You'll be able to afford the rent.
Sure. Yeah, well, again, I feel like that's not the central issue to the NII. Again, to me, the most important thing is it says you can't plan anymore. And if you're a community and you want to talk, you want to have a dialogue about what you want it to be, it shuts down that dialogue because it says what you got, that's what you get. So the question about how we best get affordable housing, I don't really think the NII says anything about affordable housing or how we...
No, but the affordable housing advocates attack it in saying that it will stop all affordable housing. But again, if we're talking about, they maintain that 80% of business will go on as normal, and that rather than it being an absolute full stop, shutdown. I think one of the issues that I have, and they certainly point out, is this strange kind of symbiotic relationship that now exists between the developers of affordable housing and these deep-pocketed, big-gun developers. And you would think, if you'd asked me back in the 70s, I'd go, oh no, these people are on completely different camps.
Mm.
But now I gather, because there's no public money, or very little, or very restricted public money for affordable housing, they kind of have to stay cozy with the big developers, like for some crumbs.
Yeah, that isn't really how it works in LA.
It
does work that way in suburban locations where, you know, some big home builder builds 2,000 houses and there's a requirement that they dedicate a certain percentage to affordable housing, and usually they don't build the affordable housing themselves, and so they've got $100 million, if I'm making up a number, of in-lieu fee, and then usually in those jurisdictions there's a single nonprofit that will take that money and then use it to build affordable housing somewhere. So again, in suburban locations, that is an accurate description of what happens. In LA, there's no money flow that I've ever seen between the deep-pocketed corporate developers who are building high-rises and affordable housing developers. If I were going to pinpoint where the appearance of collegiality comes from, it's that they both rely on the same system of general restrictions on development, but you get a pass if you're a special person. And so the deep-pocketed people, they get a pass and they can build. Let me back up for 1 second and just say there is a kind of developer getting scarcer now, but it was back in the 90s, if you talk to most corporate developers, they would tell you their business model is they want to go into a market with high barriers to entry, because then they're going to be the ones who can get in and they can build and they can reap all those rewards. And so in a certain sense, developers have been motivated historically to have these complicated systems that only they can figure out. Now, affordable housing developers have worked a similar deal, actually legislatively at the state level, and SB 1818 is a great example of this, where, okay, so if you're a deep-pocketed, well-connected, heavily lawyered corporate developer from New York with connections out here, you get a pass because you can write your own zoning. Also, if you're an affordable housing developer and you're building low-income units, you get a pass because you're doing something that has you know, legitimate social good. And so both groups benefit from our complicated, crazy system that actually hurts people more like me who are just trying to do normal projects in normal neighborhoods. As an aside on SB 1818, I took a look at SB 1818 projects a few years back, and I actually went through with a professor at UCLA and looked at every single SB 1818 project between 2005 and 2010 in LA. And again, for the uninitiated, this is a density bonus project where it's a state law that
for
says
including.
If you're building a, like I think it's a minimum of 10% very low income housing, 20.
They have three different categories.
If you're including some low income housing in your project, you get to exceed the density limits that are in place, and you get other deviations from the zoning code as well. And you could build a market rate project, and you could build some affordable housing along with it. And the theory is that by getting extra density, you get extra money, and then you can put some of that back into the community by building affordable housing. And I find it very difficult to see how that really is a serious source of affordable housing.
I do too. Although, look, in general, the Miracle Mile Residential Association, the attitudes have been favorable towards affordable housing because
absolutely,
we're seeing the middle class people, whether they were had a career as wallpaper hangers, I kid you not, or they were retired rabbis from small Jewish schools who were able to be part of the mix in these rent-stabilized units. But the issue I have with the SB 1818, at least the one building that went up in our area, is by nature, by the way the law was designed, they purposely put a firewall so the community has no input. And I know why they probably did that, because a lot of communities have very antagonistic attitudes towards affordable housing, and I think that's unfortunate. But the problem is that we as a community, particularly if we're a well-organized community, we have a lot of experience working with developers, because we've had developers.
Sure.
We've had to make deals, and we try to get the best we can for the community. They get what they need, but we know our neighborhood. We know, the garage entrance shouldn't be on this part of the block, it should be down here.
Right.
But with SB 18, they don't have to listen to us, and they don't. They don't even ask.
Right. Yeah.
And so it is, again, it's another thing that ostensibly, of course, a very good thing to add affordable housing.
Sure.
We won't even get into how the city goes around verifying whether people are really this, truly yeah, knowledgeable. Right. That's a whole lot.
Again, this is my argument. It's not a very serious source of affordable housing.
Yeah.
But it's.
But again, I think it ticks off communities because again, they don't and they won't talk to you. They don't need to. They don't need to do anything because they're bulletproof by state law. And it's these. I think it's an accumulation, if you will, of offenses or injuries or battle scars. That I think they're kind of shrewd to come out with this initiative right now.
The affordable housing.
With the neighborhood integrity.
Oh, yeah.
Because I think that there's just, maybe like the national mood, there's just a lot of people who are just kind of pissed off.
100%.
They've seen things go up. They don't know why. They don't feel like they have any say over it. They're oftentimes when these deals come along, they seem to be already be done deals. You know, it's all in the back. It's all the things that have been approved. And so I think people are just ticked off in a very irritable mood.
Yeah, well, and they should be, because they've been told one thing and they get another. Mm-hmm. And that's, and again, the same thing for me. I've been told one thing and I get another, too. Mm-hmm. It happens on all sides of this. And, you know, when I hear, I'm unpopular in some affordable housing circles. I used to build affordable housing, actually, because I don't like SB 1818. I don't like the fact that it institutionalizes the breaking of our zoning code. If we have a code, we should mean it. If we, I think our code's way too specific and way too micromanagey, and it basically demands variances because of how the level of detail it gets to. But if we adopted a more Denver-like code, or more Portland-like code, or more Seattle-like code, where they've sort of realized that you can't be specific in the ways that we are, then you don't need an SB 1818.
But then to do that, they would have to go out and build a political consensus for it.
Absolutely.
And that's what I feel like is going on right now, is that everything's an end run around the process.
Yeah, exactly. Everything's a workaround. Everything's an exception.
Yeah.
Because if it weren't for the exceptions, nothing would get done. And were the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative to pass, then nothing would get done. And again, I can't emphasize this enough, that if the danger and what scares me, I'm revealing my politics a little bit, but it's what scares me about Donald Trump as a candidate, is that if you're so angry at the system that you'll vote for Donald Trump is a vote against the system. The problem is it really isn't just that, it's also a vote for Donald Trump. And you may be really pissed off at the system, but if we elect that guy to be our president, oh my God, that would really be a multi-generational disaster.
But you're the first person I've spoken to who has spoke out against the initiative who can advocate some other way to fix this problem.
Mm.
All I'm hearing from the opponents of the initiative is that it's the end of the world.
Right.
Nothing will be done.
Right.
It's a complete freeze. That these general plans can't be updated effectively, and that it's a whole nightmare.
Yeah.
So basically, they end up, even though everyone I talk to, both sides of the issue, there is consensus here. No one likes spot zoning.
Right.
No one likes this parcel by parcel.
Well, except for some developers whose business is that.
Right. So, but none of the opponents seem to be saying, okay, no, Ken, here's how we fix this issue. And what is that? Is it a two-year timeout? Is it a moratorium?
Again, I mean, that is such a trivial piece of the bill. I know it's what they're leading with, but again, it really isn't going to impact even the projects it's targeted at significantly. Mm-hmm. Oh, I should wave my hands and get the lights to turn back on.
Is that the lights?
Or is this good enough?
I still got you.
Okay, perfect. All right, just a slightly bluer hue.
Yeah.
Okay. The two-year timeout, it doesn't really mean anything. It's not going to change the projects that are in process. It's going to maybe delay by some months the ones that are in plan check. The problem is it says you can't update your community plans anymore. And that's what we should all be focused
on. Well, you can, but you're saying they have restrictions on.
Yeah, you can update your community plan to say that what's there is what you're going to have. It's like, there was an episode of The Simpsons where Bart took his dog to obedience school and the dog wouldn't do anything, and it was time for the big test, and the teacher came over and said, okay, show us what you can do. And Bart said, sit, and the dog just ran away, and he was like, okay, go sniff that other dog. Okay,
right.
Go eat that grass.
Right.
And you know, he was sort of after the fact taking responsibility for these random things the dog was doing. And that's effectively what our planning process will become if this initiative passes. And as angry as you may be about the current system, and believe me, I spend many obsessive hours awake mm-hmm. reading about it and getting into the details and getting as pissed off as anybody, this will pull people out of planning completely. There are other things that it will do that's just it's just an artifact of the fact that it's a first draft, or a rough draft, I should say. And you know, the initiative process in California is such that often rough drafts become law, and we're left with all these unintended consequences. And here's a case where we actually know what some of the unintended consequences of the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative would be if it passes, and they're not. I mean, I don't think they're what the authors intended. I can't imagine they're what the authors intended, but they're things that are just awful. And if the initiative said, if it were just a two-year moratorium, which I probably wouldn't like, but I wouldn't have the same arguments against, if it were something that simply said that, we must update our community plans, or there's a two-year moratorium, or something like this, mm-hmm. even that would be okay. But mm-hmm. the problem is, this says stop planning completely. It also says...
By stop planning completely, you mean because of this language that restricts to context?
Yeah, it says your plan must match the majority of developed parcels, which includes parking lots and mini malls and everything.
Well, but what if it's not those more negative uses? What if you like your neighborhood because it does work for you? You like that neighborhood store, or the scale or the context is right for you. What about that?
Well, so in certain circumstances, there are neighborhoods where it probably is okay. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm thinking Pacific Palisades. Mm-hmm. If you're rich and nothing should change.
Well, I get that. But even, I like the Miracle Mile, which is in the history books because it kind of invented a form, I thought, a very rational form of urban planning.
Although, do you know that every building on Wilshire Boulevard was spot zoned?
Mm-hmm. I know, because the city would not allow A.W. Ross
exactly
to rezone it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But also at that point, up until he was in the clear when he first bought it, mm-hmm. and then the city expanded there.
Right, they added, right.
Yeah, and the city boundaries, I think, ended at La Brea when he first bought that acreage, right. And then within a couple of years, they'd move further west, and he was like, okay, now wait a minute.
Right.
But on the other hand, if you look at the, and that's one of the reasons why we're in the midst of adopting a HPOZ, mm-hmm. and we included R3 and R4s, the older mm-hmm. ones, because if you look at the way we've got commercial along Wilshire, we step down to an array of multifamily buildings in the next block. Mm-hmm. Some are 8 units, some are fourplexes, some are duplexes. We kind of stair step down in scale and height. We hit 8th Street, we roll right into R1s with a mix of duplexes.
Right.
And when I read all this new wave urban planning, I'm thinking, well, hell, we've had it since 1920.
Exactly.
And right. So when I look at these 1,700 new units, and now we've got the Purple Line extension, so we have all these construction staging sites at La Brea, mm-hmm. and Wilshire and Fairfax, which will now become TODs, mm-hmm. at a certain point, and also our zip code 90036 is mm-hmm. one of the densest populated.
A zip code I used to live in happily.
Right. So my question then becomes to the developers or the urban planners or the TOD fans is, how dense is dense? Mm. How dense do you want us? I'm speaking now about the Miracle Mile.
Sure.
To become.
It's a great question. I don't have an answer.
No, I don't. I mean. And at what point do we get to participate and say, you know what? 1700, we've got major museums. They are expanding all the time. Mm-hmm. And we're forever dealing with people I call, and I mean this lovingly, they're infused with the nobility of their purpose. Whether they're bringing us a subway.
Yeah, yeah.
Or Van Gogh's, or motion picture museums,
sure.
or automobile, they're all infused. Mm-hmm. They really believe with a passion and that they are bringing us, and they,
yeah,
and they are. We quibble about the details. sometime. And this parking issue is an interesting one, because right now, at the east end of the Miracle Mile, with the loss of a public parking lot at La Brea for subway construction, and we've got a major 175-unit infill apartment building going up behind the Desmond's Tower, which eliminated temporarily, although that project's been delayed for years. We have a situation now with the small businesses that we love, the little independently owned ones, all the historic multifamily buildings, many of which were built without parking. You talk about trying to get the city to build without parking. Well, we've got. But now what's happening is these tenants, these customers, there's no parking. City squandered their public parking meter funds. They were supposed to be building garages.
It's a whole other thing. Yeah.
It is. You know, when I go to Rodeo Drive in Beverly Hills, the most expensive real estate around, there's a public parking garage right there. Ghetto Santa Monica.
West Hollywood.
So again, when you come to the Miracle Mile and say, well, now, Ken, we need to reduce parking, I've got emails in my in-basket right now about people who are saying they either run businesses or they live in these older buildings, and there's no place for them to park.
Yeah, no question at all. I mean, I've studied parking in many neighborhoods throughout LA, and one thing that I've found, which is completely consistent with what parking experts have found in every city all around the country, LA is not special in this regard at all, is that there can be absolutely no parking available in a neighborhood, but when you look beyond the gates into the garages and these other things, you can find thousands of spaces that are available. And again, I haven't studied the Miracle Mile specifically.
No, private lots, the office buildings that used to rent out, it's become such a premium now. They won't. We've got, and that's one of the problems. We've had people who've rented spots, off-site spots, for years. But now, because of supply and demand, the demand so far outstrips the supply.
Well, so this is actually my point. It's sort of like the affordable housing problem, and I'm going to make myself very unpopular by saying what I'm about to say. I'm a huge advocate of affordability, and I think we need to be measuring how long it takes a working family to find a decent place to live with access to services in a decent neighborhood in the city. Instead, we say, how many affordable units do we have? And that doesn't get you very far, because the vast majority of low-income people do not live in subsidized housing. They live in housing that comes somewhere else. And so when you go to a neighborhood and you say, we're gonna protect against displacement by building affordable housing, it actually isn't true. Because the people who live in that affordable housing are going to be whoever needed housing the day the building's waiting list opened up and were lucky enough to win the lottery and get in there. Yeah. They're going to be from all over the place. So unless you had to move from your apartment on the day and you won the lottery, it's not for you. And so it doesn't have the stabilizing effect. Similarly with parking, what happens when you get out of the parking business as a city, when you get out of the zoning parking business, I should say, is, first of all, you realize that you need to manage parking for neighborhoods. You have to sort of swallow that pill and say, I'm going to stop having this moral epic battle with developers over the zoning code, and I'm going to start making sure that there's enough parking for the businesses in these neighborhoods, which is a very, very different thing to do. It means we have to be managing our meters effectively, we have to manage our preferential parking districts effectively, we have to build facilities and manage those effectively. I would argue West Hollywood does a fabulous job of this, comparatively.
I think they do a pretty good job on a lot of fronts.
But
they have a smaller, very engaged,
and a great professional staff, and and there's a great deal of communication. And what we do in LA is we say every new development has to be overparked. And what that does, again, is it filters out people like me who want to build more affordable, more accessible stuff. And it goes to the corporate guys who are going to build these giant parking
lots. You were just alluding, and I guess this jibes with one of my pet peeves, is I don't believe that one size fits all.
Exactly.
I have a certain experience firsthand living in the Miracle Mile. I don't want to dictate to Mar Vista. I there might be certain common denominator problems that we have with Sherman Oaks or with Silver Lake, but I respect and accept the expertise of the people who've lived there, who are engaged, and so that kind of jives with what you're saying. If they came in and studied the east end of the Miracle Mile right now, they'd say, well, we're hurting existing affordable rent-stabilized units. Right. We're making those the owners of those buildings more prone to want to sell out to developers.
Right. Exactly.
And we've got...
Or to condo convert or something like
that. Something like that. Mm-hmm. And then we've got... we've worked hard. It's hard to attract and hold on to small businesses or independently owned restaurants along that stretch. Because, yes, we've got these grand new mixed-use buildings, but they're all percentage... gross percentage.
Unless you're a national A-level tenant,
we had a little cheerleader.
That's awesome. So I mean, unless you're like a corporate A-level tenant,
it's nice to have a Chipotle and a Subway, and Starbucks and another branch of Chase, and that's great. But the businesses that people most celebrate. Uh-huh. In the Miracle Mile are the little neighborhood restaurants and joints, the Miracle Mile toys and games, the little dress shops, the little small businesses. And they are all dependent on being in these older buildings because that's the only rents. And
Which in fact is another thing that terrifies me about this initiative. The section on parking, now there's some controversy about the way this is drafted, but the section that says parking variance reform. 100% of the restaurants with conditional use permits in the Miracle Mile that are in buildings without parking will not be able to renew their conditional use permits if it really does ban parking variances. And I just don't know. Is that what we want? Do we want to say that unless you're in a mixed use building and you're a Quiznos?
I think that's the value of, and I'm willing to be wrong. I often am, of reinvesting in these community plans, because then we get into more customization. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's been a lot of tension. I know, being part of mid-city, with the spate of restaurants along Third.
Sure.
And Melrose, where they're moving, they're trying to be intelligent, use the valet system. We have an issue in the Miracle Mile, of course, with museum parking.
Mm, right.
And Lord help us, when it's a free day, it's great. I wish they had more of them, but there is nowhere to park. You'll see people, and part of our issues is what parking they do have, we don't feel sufficient, is expensive, and I guess it's an LA pastime to try to save $5 or $7 and park 7 blocks away. Mm-hmm. People say, well, we got to get people out of their cars. Well, come to the Miracle Mile. They seem to be willing to park and walk a great distance. So we have an unusual situation because, in essence, it's kind of like living near Universal's a major attraction that. To my frame of reference, and that was one of our issues with the Academy Museum, they're building no new parking. Mm-hmm. They believe that they can bring 1 million new visitors to the Miracle Mile a year, and LACMA already brings 1.2, and they've only got 600 parking spaces between them. So I hope tourists get off the plane at LAX, go to Bike Share, Bicycle Down, La Cienega, or Fairfax. I got a feeling, and also with the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, those folks don't ride a lot of bicycles. Ed Begley does, and they drive their Priuses, but they still got to have a place to park.
But that's back to getting down to very micro.
Those
are huge issues. Yeah. I bet if I stopped 10 people on the street in the Miracle Mile, 5 of them would say that's the biggest thing on their mind.
Then when you come along and people say, well, no, Ken, don't you get it? If we have to reduce parking, we're going like, what? And I'll throw one last thing that I'm going to let you talk about because I'm talking too much. In Metro's environmental impact reports, for both the Fairfax and Wilshire station. Mm-hmm. They predict a shortage of 226 on-street parking spaces per day. At the La Brea station, it's around 250.
I wonder what that means.
It means that there'll be people coming because of this subway being built really on a commuter rail mm-hmm. model. You know, in New York, you don't have 1.3 miles between subway stops. Mm-hmm. If you did, there'd only be 13 subway stops on the entire island. But when you go from Western and the next stop is La Brea, mm-hmm. that's 1.3 miles. That, to me, is more of a commuter. Mm-hmm. I'm getting on that subway not because I want to go to the Wiltern necessarily, but because I'm going downtown, mm-hmm. or I eventually need to go out to Westwood to go to UCLA for medical treatment. It's not the way, it's not the interface you have in New York, mm-hmm. or even Chicago or Boston. So that, because it is a commuter model, people will want to drive there, leave their cars and go downtown, mm-hmm. much like they use with the Gold Line. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's where these numbers come from. Mm-hmm. I think they're predicting that there'll be an extra demand. People will be coming around with their cars.
Yeah, sure.
And so now that just adds fuel to our fire. Again, everyone's infused with the nobility of their purpose. We're bringing you the subway. Mm-hmm. We're not going to give you any place to park your car.
So I think that's conflating two issues that shouldn't be conflated.
Good.
One is how much parking should there be? Mm-hmm. And the other one is how much parking should we make developers build? And those are not the same thing.
But when there's, but if the city won't spend any money to create new parking, if they're draining their parking meters for their general revenue.
Which they shouldn't be doing.
But they've been doing now for 15 years.
Understood, yes.
Every year they declare it surplus.
Right.
Sweep it into the general fund.
Right.
Then we too are kind of like others in this town. We're trying to glom on to the deep pocket developers mm-hmm. to say, hey, the city can't scratch this itch. Can you?
Right. And the problem is when we make developers do it, what it does again is it filters out the little guys. And when the big guys build their giant buildings, which is what you have to do to justify all that parking, and they build their big parking decks, first of all, it's usually an urban design disaster. It destroys a sidewalk. Mm-hmm. And then more importantly, it actually doesn't help. And this is what all of the parking research has shown over the last 15 years, that people have this idea of spillover parking, that you're building a building, you want to be able to park everybody in that building so they don't spill out into mm-hmm. the neighborhood. That actually isn't how spillover parking works. It works in exactly the opposite direction. You build a big new building, the developers have to, you know, get the money back for their parking, so they charge for it. Mm-hmm. And what happens is 89% of the people in the building, when they show up in the morning, drive around in the neighborhood and park on the street. And then when that gets filled up, then they reluctantly start spilling into the building. Even people with parking permits mm-hmm. will often park on the street just because it's a little bit more convenient and it's faster.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is why we see a pattern that's been repeated over and over again in really every neighborhood in the country. I personally observed it in Westwood, where there could be 8 parking meters available and 2,000 or 3,000 spaces off street. Brentwood, exactly the same thing. Melrose, mm-hmm. all of West Hollywood, this happens. And it's, and I should say, West Hollywood, they've actually flipped this dynamic a little bit through some new policies, which are brilliant. But the danger is that we create these massive projects because we require them to build all this parking, and you need the big project to support the parking. You get corporate developers, and then you have a worse problem than you started with, because everybody who's going to that building's parking on the street anyway. And so
when they can, now in our area, we've got more preferential parking to help protect, because again, a lot of these buildings, particularly between Wilshire and 8th, never had any parking to begin with.
Right. Yeah, so you see that's the only parking you needed.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, and so then in commercial districts, what you need to do is get the employees to park somewhere out of the main drag.
We're trying, and we in the academies rented spaces from the Peterson, mm-hmm. and with our deal with the El Rey Theater, AEG, mm-hmm. is that you have to prove that you use off-site parking mm-hmm. to even get in.
Right. Oh, interesting. That's interesting.
Because they have no parking.
Mm-hmm.
But they.
Well, and then
we try to take advantage, but there's a point, and that's what we're experiencing now at the eastern end of the Miracle Mile. where the now the demand so exceeds the supply that is causing duress.
So I would say getting big giant developers in there to build big giant parking garages is the opposite of the right solution. I guess I have a general philosophy that just because a problem is bad doesn't mean you should take heroic actions that'll make it worse. And I think our approach to dealing with parking poor areas like that, where we hope for a messianic developer to come in and solve all the problems, it never works. It never ever works. And what I would recommend,
they promise sometimes.
Well, because again, it's not about how much you can't count the number of spaces and from that determine if there's enough parking. What you have to look at is how are people using the spaces, and can a visitor in 5 minutes or less find a space? And I should add that what's sort of confounding a lot of this stuff is ride hailing services like Uber and Lyft. You know, a lot of places like on 3rd Street and in Hollywood that even have zoning requirements, you know, through the approvals process of valet parking. Many valet operators I've talked to have reported drop-offs of up to 50% in the past several years.
I know my son is 30, and everyone, his generation, if they know they're going to be drinking, they're just staying out late. They all are an Uber.
And I'm older than 30, but I live in an apartment that doesn't have a parking space, and I do most of my trips on bike, on the subway, or in a ride-hailing service. I have a car, and I use it sometimes, but I try to avoid it as much as possible. So, but anyway, you know, the point being that rather than choosing the sort of indirect ways of solving our problems, like hoping we get a really good developer and hoping the zoning code works and hoping the process works, we should be banding together and just demanding that the city solve these problems, you know, help them solve these problems.
See, it seems to me to take shock therapy with the city, that they won't change one iota until they are forced to.
I agree. There's a revolutionary type of thing that has to happen. I mean, it can happen through exceptional leadership. I mean, maybe an amazing visionary council person will show up. Maybe that's about as likely as an amazing developer showing up and solving all the neighborhood's problems.
Well, and also this one who we haven't really gotten into, and it's just a fact, is this the way it works with council districts and council members here? It's fiefdoms.
Right.
And we're very lucky now in CD4 to have a new representative in David Rue, who refuses to take campaign contributions from the developers, who's also very transparent. He posts on his site and he meets to hear about a new development project. So to reduce the surprise.
Very cool.
We can say, okay, they're talking to someone about this.
And he's got great staff too, who are very professional, who understand the issue.
But for a lot of people, a lot of my friends or colleagues around the city who are constantly being caught off guard, and they realize it's all up to the council member. Not for good or bad, it could be a good project, the council member doesn't like it. And that is, so when you talk about, we've been sold a bill of goods on the community plans, it's almost compounded by the fact that we think as citizens, unless we do something crazy like Prop U, which I supported, and I know planners going, that's awful, worst thing ever happened to but to me, that's grassroots democracy. Much like this, it might be an imperfect initiative, but if enough people, particularly in a disconnected town like LA, if they drag themselves off their recliner chair, their stressless recliners, and get on their bikes or in their SUVs or take Uber and get to the polling place to vote against it, then that's democracy, and it is a messy, imperfect thing.
Yeah. Again, I'm scared that this will be a campaign of slogans, and it'll be a campaign. This is being treated as a referendum on our current process, and what it really is, it's not. It's a referendum on this initiative.
I think you just hit on something, Mark, because I do see, I'm sitting here behind the camera thinking, it is a referendum on the process.
Which is like saying Donald Trump is a referendum
on
our process.
I know, and I'm not going to vote for Donald Trump, but I'm right now, so far, I'm inclined only in this sense, and I wrote in an article, that the ship as it exists is hit an iceberg, and the only lifeboat available is the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative. So I'm going to argue, well, it's not the perfect vessel for me. You know, it's like
it's more like an incinerator than a lifeboat.
I know.
Again,
but that's why I wanted to talk to you. Obviously, we're two eminently rational guys.
Obviously.
And we're not going to fix anything.
Yeah.
I mean, at least we're trying to deal with the weather here in LA. And it seems to me that this has become so contentious between residents, whether it all gets commingled, McMansions, developments, these lawsuits, these situations were like the Target store, they become little poster children. Mm-hmm. You know, they want to. Garcetti encourages them to build a 74-foot-tall Target store in an area with a community plan. It's got a 35-foot height limit, and then people sue, and now everyone's saying, "Well, what's going on? Who's right?" People say, "What's wrong with having a 74-foot Target?" Nothing, to my point of view, if it conforms with your community plan.
Right. Well, and then I just come back and I say, well, then why would we approve an initiative that keeps us from ever making a new community plan that's different from what's out there? Mm-hmm. Again, that
or restricts our ability to make a community
plan. Yeah. Well, I mean, it says that if you make a community plan, you've got to basically copy whatever's there right now. Mm-hmm. And I
this initiative are things like this, the ballot box.
Sure.
How do we compel change? In City Hall, how do we do this?
A great question. To me, in all honesty, this really is scary because I know what the process is like. Something else that the initiative is going to do, if it passes, is it's going to turn every building permit into a discretionary approval subject to the California Environmental Quality Act, meaning that you want to install a toilet or put up a fence, your neighbor could sue you under CEQA. And that is just insane, absolutely insane. And again, I think that the proponents of this, who I don't know what their intentions are, but I assume they're well-meaning, they're not thinking about the downside of this. And, and really, for them, this is absolutely a referendum on our current state of affairs. And I just wish they had kept it to that in the ballot language, because the ballot language goes so much beyond saying we need a change and we have to shake things.
I think it's because of a lack of trust with this kind of feudal system, with the council district.
I agree. Trust is the main deficiency.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that also. I read Street's blog. That's how I found you. I'm a shades of gray guy, but I do think that the advocates for density, or who follow Professor Shoup and his philosophies of parking management or the benefits of reducing parking and all that, haven't done a very good job of communicating to just us mere mortals, the residents of LA.
No disagree.
I think that just in terms of the messy, I think I always had a sense that these are edicts that are coming out of lecture halls, a group of doctorate students or whatever, you know, this is the way the world should be, and then they're presented to us, and I'm going, wait a minute, I've lived here for 30 years. I've got museums here, older buildings here in the park. How does this, what are you smoking?
Yeah, when I go to my favorite neighborhoods around the country, around the world, none of them were built with a process like we have. None of them were built with the sort of theories that drive our urban planning now. They were much more practical, much more basic, down to earth, let's make it nice and let's make it work. And there was generally much more of a connection between the people building the stuff and the people using the stuff and living there. And I personally have a big problem with the over-institutionalization of our land use process, where people are completely disconnected from it. It's kind of like SB 1818. It's like the reason they don't talk to the community is because it's much, much, much more valuable for them to conform to this theoretical construct.
Yeah.
And believe me, as a developer, they put tons of energy into conforming to that theoretical construct that was created by negotiation with a bunch of weird academic debates in Sacramento, nowhere near us. And it makes me crazy, because I would much rather have a dialogue with people who live in a neighborhood and work in a neighborhood. And I can tell you that it's something that it's an ethic that we stand by, but it's not good business anymore to do that, because you get the way we've built our planning system, even doing by right projects, you run into trouble if you try to be contextual, and if you try to look at the building next to you and say, I'd like to respond to that, you get into big trouble. So a lot of people say, I'm just not going to do it. I'm going to look at the text of the code, I'm going to follow that to the letter, and that's what's going to get built. And so what are the other things that I think will absolutely come out of the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative if it passes, is the only game in town for development is going to be redevelopment of existing parcels that are a little bit underdeveloped. So basically, like the apartment buildings, the fourplexes and the duplexes and the sixplexes and the Miracle Mile, those will be the only game in town to condo convert, to demolish and build new, because there's often a little bit of spare zoning there that's already in place and nobody has to do anything with. And again, I think 100% our system needs to be upended, but we shouldn't upend it with this tyrannical thing that will completely pull neighborhoods out of the planning process, will destroy the housing that's there now, and will create this barrage of lawsuits and madness where nobody's going to know what our planning system's going to be at the other end. So it's so hard, because when you're looking at this terrible system, and you get you probably for decades people have been getting angrier and angrier and angrier, and finally here's an escape valve, but it really is shooting ourselves. This particular language is shooting ourselves in the head, and we have to stop treating it like we're voting on the current system, because we're not. We're voting on the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative,
I know,
which is a terrible thing.
I know, and I think that's why we find ourselves in a perfect storm.
Yeah.
We've got unresolved, unremitting anger and frustration meeting a ridiculously complex and wackadoodle system.
Yeah, there are only two people who know what the zoning code says. It's
And so that we're all, I don't know what our choices are. I'm speaking for myself as a resident of Miracle Mile. I'm fed up now. Maybe people living in other parts of town are not as
agitated. I think pretty much everyone's
fed up. I think this is a situation where rational people should have seen this coming, should have been addressing this issue over these last 10 or 20 years, and because left unattended, you get unintended reactions.
Yeah.
And that's where we're at now. And I don't know. It's going to be a lengthy ballot. There'll be lots of things to vote on there. Yeah, it's a presidential year. Who knows how far down the ballot people are going to go? That's beyond my pay grade. I don't know. But one thing I am happy about, regardless of whether the initiative passes or fails, is that I hope it's going to provoke more dialogue.
And it already has, and that is good.
And I think it has to be, and people have to get really honest with themselves, not just the pro-density people, but everyone, the residents too.
Well, I'll tell you something I appreciate about what you're doing, is when you look at the kind of dialogue that's happening about the initiative, it's all campaigning. And unfortunately,
the ballot measure, that's how they roll.
Right. No, that's right. I'm on both sides of it. And fortunately, neither you nor I have a dog in the fight, so we don't have to campaign. And we can actually have a policy conversation about it. And that's what we so desperately need, is these important things that really should be policy questions are answered like campaign questions. And so on both sides of it, what you're going to
hear... Yeah, I see it on both sides. Yeah. I filmed a debate between... Jill Stewart and Larry Kaplan, and some of the things Mr. Kaplan said were like, when he was adamant about, there'll be no new building, there'll be no hospitals, there'll be no schools, there'll be nothing. And
It's true about the schools and the parks, but that's a different thing.
Yeah, it's a different thing. So
actually, schools, there's an exception.
And I get it, when you're in a debate and you don't have time to annotate and do footnotes, you're just having to take positions, and that's how campaigns work. But you're right, it's going to be, we have to, there's going to take a lot of myth-busting.
Yes.
From both sides.
Yes.
And because a lot of this is very subjective, it's very anecdotal, and what are the facts? And that's why that's what my trouble is with some of these big theories, like the trickle-down housing. I'm going, okay, at what point? We got 1,700 units, we got two affordable, we have to do 3,400 luxury rate units to get four affordable? At this rate, this theory doesn't compute.
Well, so what does compute, and I appreciate that, by the way, the critique of the theory is often the market will not create low-income housing. And that's actually true.
Yeah.
And one of the things, interestingly, that I found when looking at the SB 1818 cases is that the vast majority, I have to think of it's over 90% of affordable units created under SB 1818 are in 100% affordable projects. So they're not, it doesn't work robustly as an incentive for market rate developers to create a significant number of affordable units. It is an easier way for affordable housing developers to build more affordable housing, which I'm all in support of. The more affordable housing we build, the better. But I think it's a little bit of a false dichotomy to say you're either doing trickle down or you're doing low income or whatever. The problem is, in supply-constrained markets like LA, where we've got a 2.7% vacancy rate, housing gets fabulously expensive very quickly. And a lot of people don't understand how gentrification works. They imagine that what happens is that a neighborhood gets popular and suddenly all of the lower-income tenants are kicked out and hipsters move in. And that does happen a little bit anecdotally, but what happens much more normally is there's always a churn of people in a neighborhood. And in fact, low-income neighborhoods, people are churning very rapidly because low-income people don't have a lot of stability in their lives.
No.
And but in a non-gentrifying low-income neighborhood, a low-income family moves out of a unit, a low-income family moves into a unit. In a gentrifying neighborhood, a low-income family moves out of a unit, then a higher-income family moves in. And what all of the recent research has shown is that in gentrifying neighborhoods, actually, low-income people leave at a slower rate than they leave low-income neighborhoods.
If they've got rent stabilized.
Actually, no, that's not the...
No, they don't have about homeowners.
No, that's not... It doesn't matter, rent stabilized or not. I mean, landlords, most landlords don't have enough of a finger on the pulse to... Nor do they kick out good tenants, even if they can get a little bit more money. Again, it does happen, but it's not the norm. And across cities...
we've seen such a spike in Ellis Act evictions recently.
So, okay, well, so this gets, I'm sorry, I'm going on and on about this.
Have to cut this into two parts, but let's keep
going. That's all good. Yeah. I mean, this is more the punchline of where I'm headed, that even without rent control, low-income families move out at a slower rate, just because they want to hang on. And sometimes they end up paying a bigger percentage of their income and all that other stuff. But when... The reason why you experience this more intense demographic shift, and that's really what we see, it's not so much displacement as it's a demographic shift, or what some people call exclusionary gentrification, is because housing is ultimately a game of musical chairs. And again, in a low-income neighborhood, somebody leaves the game, somebody enters the game, and there's a balance. In a declining neighborhood, and by the way, declining neighborhoods are much more prevalent than gentrifying neighborhoods.
It's particularly if you get south of the 10th Freeway.
Exactly.
And that's one of my issues. So just keep... This is all about what I think are already successful areas that have amenities, that have housing.
Well, and so...
we're not paying any attention to South Central.
So the challenge is it's just obviously true that rich people get dibs because they're more powerful and they have a lot of
the rich are very different from you
and I. And the middle and the middle class get dibs over the poor.
Right, although I see I don't mean it should be that way. Right. In the Miracle Mile, I see an erosion of the middle class.
Yeah, right. Well, absolutely.
The way it's going.
Absolutely. Yeah. And so it is absolutely true that if we restrict the number of chairs for the rich, that they're going to take chairs from the middle class. And if we restrict the number of chairs in the middle class, they're going to take chairs from the poor. That's it just there's that trickle down is very real. And so the point isn't that we should allow unlimited density so that we get affordable housing.
Well, because that's also based on the concept that developers would work against their own self-interest by overbuilding to such an extent that the prices would collapse.
Right. If you want to get affordable housing, exactly.
Yeah.
But it is absolutely...
That's the thing. That's the part of that logic. That's the saying, well, if GM makes enough cars, too many cars, it will lower the price of their cars to a certain point.
But it is also true that if you open a market to competition, prices will drop.
Right.
And what we've seen in cities like Denver and even Seattle and Portland and even Washington, D.C., they've let enough housing get built that actually rents have dropped, even though the economies have continued to climb. Now, an affordable housing advocate listening to me will say, but that has not provided affordable housing for the poor. And I would say, you're absolutely right. It has not done that. What it has done is it's protected the middle class. And we should stop. You know, we basically have two choices. We can... It's my approach to everything is to be direct. I don't believe in bank shots. I don't believe in magic. I don't believe in the alchemy of zoning in theory. I just don't believe it. What I do believe is in the law of supply and demand, that you can certainly slow price appreciation by allowing supply to increase. There's no debate about that. But it doesn't follow from that you're going to get supply at the bottom of the price curve. That doesn't, 25 years from now, yes, but now, no.
Yeah.
And so what some people have said is because that's true, what we should do is we should put pressure on the middle, and this is theoretical, and it's the kind of theory that I hate. Mm-hmm. We should suppress production at the middle and wait for a developer to show up and then say, you must build some affordable housing to increase supply at the low end. And unfortunately, while we're waiting for that messianic developer to show up to build 5,000 units, 10 of which will be for very low-income families, we've stopped the normal production of housing all around, which has accelerated this musical chairs game where the middle class have taken housing from the poor and the rich have taken housing from the middle class. And you can just go to Silver Lake if you want to see that in action, or go to Santa Monica if you want to see that in action. These places that have been... you know, really lost their middle class except for a smattering of rent-controlled units. And so the answer, constraining supply only makes things worse. And you're correct that, you know, 1,700 units is not going to get you affordable housing, period. Done.
Yeah.
And that shouldn't be, we should stop pretending it will.
Well, but we'll be facing another round of this in the Miracle Mile with the transit-oriented development, these metro-owned sites at La Brea and Fairfax. Mm-hmm. And you have to remember, on our stretch of Wilshire, there's no height limits. So that'll be another interesting...
There's FAR limits, though.
Huh?
There is FAR limits, I believe, right? It's either 3-1 or something like that.
Not that I'm aware of, right on Wilshire.
I'm pretty sure there's a floor area ratio limit, but anyway, your point probably stands.
There always is an FAR. I don't know it off the top of my head. Yeah. But we're going to be facing the same thing of transit-oriented development, which maybe you can point out a project that Metro's done so far that really meets the mark in terms of...
I'll tell you my favorite TOD.
What is your
favorite? I'm gonna make enemies with this too. I think TOD is a bit of a myth.
I do too.
I think what really matters is walking oriented development.
Yeah.
Some recent studies have shown by Dan Chapman at UC Berkeley that distance from, like, if you build housing near a transit station, that doesn't predict automobile use by the residents. What does predict it is how little parking you provide. So if you build 10 units and the people in those units are people like me who don't want to drive, then the people who live there,
they've got the incomes to pay those rents.
Well, but actually, units without parking always cost less than units with parking.
Right, but you know, again, it's about if this magic. What is the magic number? 30 you should.
Pay 30, no more yeah, than, 30%.
Yeah,
30%. Yeah, good luck with that.
Good luck with that.
Well, but if you're not paying for your car use, it does help a little bit. But that's not that you're. The point is, if your goal, narrow goal, get people to stop driving so much, you'll be providing housing for people like me mm-hmm. who don't want to drive so much. Mm-hmm. Another very strong predictor of whether people will use their cars or not is whether they live within a quarter mile of a grocery store. And so,
particularly in my house, we went to Smart and Final this morning. It's a two-person operation, and I've got a SUV. We fill it up.
There you go.
She buys paper towels and vast quantities.
But if you lived a block away from the Smart and Final, whatever you
maybe
need,
maybe I could. She'd be sending me down there every 10 minutes. It'd probably be better for my health.
Right. Okay. You have a little cart.
Yeah.
But it is. This is true.
You know, that makes sense.
And so we should really be doing.
I know that's going to struggle with downtown, with the folks moving downtown, waiting for a big.
Well, I live close to a CVS, and I live close to some neighborhood markets. And for me, I use Instacart,
right.
So I don't actually have
to.
But you know, getting what we should be doing is building high rises around every supermarket in town, and then we don't know.
Well,
car pump.
I'd be happy.
I mean, I'm being a little facetious, but. Okay, so anyway, that was a long way around to TOD.
Yeah.
We suffer from wanting every project to be a microcosm of the perfect world.
Yeah.
And you don't need to solve all the world's problems with every project, and you shouldn't, because if you try, you're going to really screw it up.
Well, what is it? A camel's a horse designed by a committee?
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. You get into these odd, and that's what I look at when I drive along at Wilshire and Vermont. I look at that and I go, what is that?
Yeah, it's a
why does that not look like I don't want to walk around.
Well, so my favorite TOD in LA, which was not built by Metro as far as I know, or I don't think Metro had any Metro had a small involvement actually in terms of the parking structure, is the Mission Meridian project in South Pasadena.
I haven't if I've seen it. Where is it now?
So it's at the South Pasadena, the Mission Avenue Gold Line station.
Oh, I've been through it on the train, mm-hmm. but I never got off the train.
It's a gorgeous project. I really recommend it. It's Stefanos Polizoides, uh-huh. the architect, and it's like it is. Countered my other point, it is a microcosm of your neighborhood. Mm-hmm. On Mission, it's I think a 3 or 4 story commercial, mm-hmm. a residential building over retail with mm-hmm. sort of loft style apartments. Mm-hmm. And then as you go back, it's more of a courtyard style apartment building. And as you go more to the back, it's these fourplexes, duplexes, and mm-hmm. single family homes mm-hmm. that are built very sensitively to the style mm-hmm. of the surrounding homes. And so it just flows right into the neighborhood.
Well, see, that's an argument for context. That's what the whole issue with McMansion's been about.
Yeah.
That's why we fought them so, so bitterly and hard in the Miracle Mile. They're just so out of context.
Right.
It's like they dropped out from down from outer space.
You know what they dropped in from? They can drop in from the internet, actually. Because getting to my earlier argument, uh-huh. that what we should be doing is talking to the community,
uh-huh.
and instead what we're doing is we're responding. And I'm sorry for getting so theoretical, but developers and general contractors and people who mm-hmm. are building mansions are responding to this theoretical world that we've built in this really complex set of codes. And so what happens is people discover if they can check the box on every code requirement,
mm-hmm.
then they can get through. And
once one guy finds a loophole, they share it with the other one. They say, okay, this is how you get around that. And that's.
And you can download plans, housing, you should try this when you go home. Go look on the internet. You can mm-hmm. download McMansion plans for like $4,000.
Ready to go. Is that why they all look alike?
That's one of the reasons they all look alike.
Yeah.
I could design my house, I could pay my architect $30,000 to design a house for me. Or I could download a McMansion for $4,000 that is guaranteed basically to pass every step of the way.
And I love that. That's great.
And it's one of the miserable unintended consequences of this overly complicated, dehumanized system that we've created.
Okay, so if you were king, what process would we use to fix this planning system in LA?
Okay, I have the answer is two parts. The first thing is I would look to the best model of the best plan ever written in my book, which is the Chicago Plan of 1911. And that was a completely different kind of plan than what we do now. So what we do now is we go through this complex, litigious, expensive, time-consuming ritual of creating these magical documents that don't really mean anything. And what they're intended to do is tell every property owner what they're going to do with their property. And I you know, being a property owner, talking to property owners, they don't look to the plans for guidance. The plans are limiting is what they can do without asking for special permission, but the plan has no moral authority at all. It doesn't mean anything. I don't look at a plan that says my property is zoned for high rise and like, oh, I better build a high rise. I say, what can I do? What do I want to do? What does my family do? What is the neighborhood doing? So that the fact that our plans attempt to script private behavior is very strange. Again, limiting private behavior that's going to be problematic for other people, legitimate use of the plans. But to use them as creative things that are intended to, you know, as I said, all this argument about high rises in Hollywood in the general plan, or in the plan update, it makes me laugh because nobody cares, no developer cares that it says they should build high rises. They don't think that it means that. So anyway, and in the meantime, while we're all having these lawsuits and conversations about what the plans say and what I can do with my property, over on the other side, the things that are actually most central to how you and I experience the city, the sidewalks, the streets, the parks, the schools, the beach, all of our public resources, our transit system, all of those things are scattered into a million different things, million different agencies, million different plans that aren't really plans. They're completely disconnected. And generally, in LA, the way we build our streets and our sidewalks and our other public goods is we put our finger over the hose of development until a big developer that's forceful enough comes through and we say, we want you to build us these streets and widen this street and build these sidewalks and do all, and fix our problems. And what ends up happening is we get the public realm by negotiation, project by project by project, and we lose control of it as the public.
Yeah, so, in terms of a cohesive,
So the promotional brochure for the 1911 Chicago Plan by Daniel Burnham begins with the statement saying something more or less like, we are the citizens of Chicago, the great stockholders in this incredible corporation. And don't we owe it to ourselves to maximize the value of what we own in common? And so that's the premise of the plan. The plan says,
sounds good to me.
Let's plan our city. It doesn't talk about private property. It says, let's plan our city. And if you ask the average person what a city planner does, they would think that a city planner figures out how wide the sidewalks should be and where the parks are going to go and stuff like that. And that isn't what city planners do at all. They write magical rules that are intended to shape development and fail. And so I say, let's look to the Chicago plan as an example of what we should be doing. We should be taking back control of our city and managing it for our common benefit because we all own it. It's ours. And would it be incredible if we actually planned our city? The key thing is the Chicago plan started with what do we as the citizens control? We actually do control the public properties. Secondly, it said, how do we pay for all this? What are the specific physical interventions we're going to make? It didn't say Chicago, Michigan Avenue should be a multi-use street, blah, blah. It doesn't say that. It says, this part of Michigan Avenue, we're going to straighten out this bend and we're going to add trees. It was very specific. That's what a specific plan is in my book. The third thing it said is, how are we going to pay for it? And the fourth thing it said is, how are we going to go to the state capitol and get laws changed so we can actually implement this plan?
Yeah.
That's real planning.
Yeah.
And I wish that we would do that because I think that the things that are important to most of us, is there enough parking? That could go in the plan. Is the transit in the right place? That could go in the plan. That's real planning, and I think we would all be a lot saner if we stopped trying to plan things we don't control start planning things we do control.
Because regardless of what side of the issue you're on, everyone's forced into being reactionaries.
Completely.
All the time.
Yeah.
And I think that's has such a negative contribution to the tower.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and then we get down to, and we're going to end on this, is infrastructure.
Yes.
It seems to me, when I look at the water mains and our, now we're talking about trying to hold on to the water, when we do get rain.
Yeah, stormwater retention.
One of the arguments, you know, for this initiative and slowing things down is, guys, infrastructure. How do we keep adding and adding new buildings, developments, on top of what everyone seems to acknowledge the city doesn't like to. They don't do the monitoring or the reports that they've promised they would do. So many people argue that, you know, until we have an accurate, honest read on our infrastructure, whether to deal with policing or emergency medical services, we got to take a time out. Is that a reason, another reason to have a moratorium?
Well, again, the moratorium's not real.
I know, but I mean, in terms of a timeout.
I think it's important because if we talk about it as though it's real, then people think it's real. And the moratorium really isn't because it doesn't really impact most projects, and even the projects it's intended to impact, it's not going to make that much of a difference too. So I don't think that is an argument.
Because the idea is in terms of updating the general plan,
Which we're not going to be able to do.
Yeah. But I mean, in terms of, or would be limited in how it would be done, would also affect addressing the issues in infrastructure in LA. Because that is, and I believe it from my own experience, that we're worried about the structure, but we're not paying any attention to the foundation.
Yeah.
And so, the development in Hollywood, okay, groovy. I do know it takes many times the ambulance from my fire district is on weekends is posted in Hollywood. And if there's a 911 call in the Miracle Mile, it's fire engines answering.
Interesting.
Okay. So, and then we all know about the water mains and everything else. It's a whole, this isn't, but at some point, we've got to, if we're going to keep building this city, it seems to me we're going to have to address infrastructure. And that's, and you know, as a builder, no one likes the money they can't see behind this wall. You know, the pipes and wires and struts. And
well, although as a builder, I'll tell you, it's very valuable assumptions you make about.
I know.
What's back there?
Yeah.
Well, naturally, I have a contrarian view about this. My answer is, well, first of all, the moratorium isn't a real moratorium, so it's not. I want to push that aside, but your question, which is a legitimate question, highlights one of the most insane things about our planning process, which is we have stopped planning infrastructure as a city. I mean, yeah, we do. We've got some, you know, when I last looked at the city budget, I think it spends about $300 million a year on infrastructure, which is a very goodly sum, without strategy, I might add. The people aren't. I remember somebody pointing out that they tore up the Colorado Boulevard in Eagle Rock to put new sewer mains in. Then they repaved it. Then they repainted it. And then they did it again to put bike lanes in right afterwards.
Yeah.
So like there are a lot of these uncoordinated efforts, but the money's wasted. But the way the city actually plans infrastructure now, and it's not, I have to say, this is not unique to LA, this is America in 2016, it's everywhere.
It's a nationwide problem.
Is we make developers do it. And so, and this is because our planning process was designed by Herbert Hoover when he was the Secretary of Commerce in the late 20s. And this is, not too many people know about this, but literally he created this whole suburban planning model, and he put it into two sort of model legislative packages, the Standard City Planning Enabling Act and the Standard State Zoning Enabling Act, which were spread all over the country. And their intention was to create a suburban single-family home ownership country, which they succeeded in doing, and then we immediately got the Great Depression. But this style of planning, which is all geared towards the new subdivision, is what we use. And what that style of planning says is when a developer comes in to build his single family homes, he should be the one who puts in the cul-de-sacs and the...
Yeah.
And it makes sense if you're doing the new growth subdivision.
Yeah. If it's a soybean field, it's being converted into housing.
Yes, indeed.
But it's not necessarily relevant to an urban.
And so what's happened is that education, the engineers and the planners got that education. That's what you do, is you negotiate with developers over the quality of infrastructure they're going to put in. And so our, again, nationally, city planning departments and city engineering departments are largely there to, you know, deal with a burst water main when it happens. But more importantly, to respond to development applications to say, we need a new water main? Well, let's make this developer put it in.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's all... So what this does, it means that South LA doesn't get anything because there's no development.
Because they have no development. That's exactly it.
And, yeah. And what it means is that...
It's a kind of an ipso facto red line.
If infrastructure
and community benefits are all dependent on developer investment,
yes.
Then we've kind of drawn a red line.
I agree. And what it means also is that we need mega developers to come in who are going to be our messiahs and fix all this stuff. And so I would say the cure for this is to take back the public realm from private developers and make it the city's business, make it the public's business to plan and manage the public realm, and just let developers, and I say do Denver style envelope limits. You know, you can't build beyond this envelope. And kind of leave it at that. Take back the public realm and stop making it a matter of negotiation.
I think it's a good place to end right now. I think we'll probably have another conversation.
I would love it.
Let's see how these events unfold.
I would thoroughly enjoy it.
Thank you, Mott.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.